3 issues in, and Wee Boy Cable is holding its own as one of the most entertaining and well-crafted books in the Dawn of X. Today I'll answer, what happened between Cable and Deadpool? What happened to the original Galador, home of the Spaceknights? And is the death of Old Man Cable, back in Extermination, suddenly an open murder mystery? That's right, we're talking about Cable number 3 here in the Dawn of X. I'm Dave Busing, founder and editor-in-chief of comicbookherald.com. You are listening to Krakin Krakoa number 75. Let's talk Cable and theories. We got a big Deadpool appearance here in Cable number 3. If you like Comic Book Herald YouTube channel or podcast, please consider liking, subscribing, and sharing. Spoilers for discussed comics will follow. So, this issue by Gerry, Phil Noto, and letters by Joe Sabino opens with Teen Cable reliving his murder of his adult self until he's pulled back to reality by Esme, the cuckoo he's currently taking on a date. Although apparently, as we found in Cable number 2, he's currently dating all of them, all 5 of the cuckoos, which feels like a showdown in the making with poor, killed every issue, Quentin Quire, who finally hooked up with a cuckoo in the pages of the most recent X-Force issue, number 11. That's kind of neither here nor there, though. I expect to do a full Stuffer Cuckoos deep dive once they get a little more involved in the Dawn of X, because I think there's some really interesting ways that that might happen. So in Cable number 2, the Space Knights of Galador also return to reclaim the sword Cable found, the Light of Galador, which is much more powerful than just a sharp blade, and the Space Knights say can help them turn Earth into their very own new Galador. Before we get there, though, and kind of to avoid losing the plot, Cable was originally in Philadelphia when the Space Knights found him, and in Philly he was investigating a missing mutant baby. At the end of Cable number 3, the captors are revealed to be the Order of X, who Phil Noto, doing incredible work throughout, depicts as these manically grinning cultists cutting X's across their faces and stealing little mutant babies. I think there's a few kind of ways that the Order of X is crossing over. I think one, I'm pretty sure this is the same cult we've seen in the pages of the Gerry Duggan written Marauders. It also feels like a throwback to a sinister secret about those weird looky-loos wearing all white robes. You know, at the time it was kind of like, why are we bringing possibly like the KKK into this? And it's probably the Order of X now based on what they're wearing here. And all we know about them really from this tease is they're stockpiling mutant babies. So somebody get Nanny and Orphan Maker from Hellions on the case quick, because Cable seems to be mildly occupied. Galadorians, getting back to them, are hellbent on getting their planet back. And lo and behold, it looks like a time machine is the only option. You know, they have lost their civilization, and these 3, with the Light of Galador in their possession, are saying, they woke up and their planet's gone, right? It's a tough break, tough stuff. And they're looking to get back. Cable, you know, hears time travel, and he thinks, hey, that's kind of my thing. I can probably actually help. I was curious, too, like, okay, what actually happened to the Space Knights' home planet? Why don't they have a Galador to return to? I had kind of assumed, and I was thinking, that Galador was destroyed in Rom Space Knight when Galactus came a-callin', which was in issues 25 to 27. But it actually didn't happen most recently until 2013's Infinity Event, which is, of course, an event written by Jonathan Hickman, you know, during his run on Avengers, New Avengers, etc., in the build to Secret Wars. So it's kind of an opening, sequence there where they are destroyed by the Builders. I don't know that that specifically is a thing that's really going to come back into the play. I don't know what that means. Back into play, just with the Builders in general. But it is interesting that it happened somewhat recently in a Hickman-written event. Lil Nate doesn't have time. He doesn't have the time travel tech that he needs on him. So he goes to Old Man Cable's grave. Again, the old man he killed in the Extermination event. He finds a not-so-subtle clue leading to Deadpool, who, you know, as of recently, as of the Kelly Thompson-written run on the character, is the king of Staten Island and a host of a bunch of Marvel Universe monsters. It's actually a very good fit for Deadpool and an interesting read in and of itself. The whole sequence is a nice return to Deadpool for Gerry Duggan and a fun reflection of the long-running frenemyship the characters have shared throughout the 2000s. Now, if you're not a big Deadpool fan, don't read a lot of his issues, you might be slightly less familiar with this, but Cable and Deadpool, they go way back. Again, they have a series literally called Cable and Deadpool that ran from 2004 to 2008. I remember really enjoying it at the time, although I imagine a lot of it doesn't hold up, which is kind of the curse of the pool. But Gerry Duggan came on to Deadpool circa Marvel Now 2012, and he wrote a story in Despicable Deadpool before House of X and Powers of 10 all happened called Deadpool Kills Cable. And it was all about Deadpool trying to kill Cable. As you might expect, there's a whole lot of strife stuff, which is interesting. And, you know, it being Deadpool and Cable, there's a weird wrinkle where, like, he wants to kill him, but also they've been friends for a long time. It's complicated. Now, I'll call out here that we've also just seen Deadpool try to gain passage to Krakoa in the pages of Deadpool number 6. So if you're interested in weaving all this together, check out the comic book Herald Dawn of X reading order. I think there's, you know, a lot of maybe readers newer to Marvel are kind of wondering, like, Deadpool, he's a mutant, right? Like, he kind of jokes about the X-Men movie sometimes. And Deadpool number 6 does a really good job sort of showing what his status is and the fact that he is actually, as it stands, not allowed on Krakoa. So following that rejection, I think it's fair to say that Cable is one of only a handful of X characters who Pool would make time for. He also lets Teen Cable get away with old Cable's arm pretty easily, which makes me think something's up. Like, maybe there's a little more setup here, and we're going to see more from Deadpool in the rest of this Cable series. So in back-to-back letter data pages, Old Man Cable tells Wade he wants him to recover his body upon the unlikely event of his death. Deadpool replies perfectly in a very old-fashioned handwritten letter, and aside from the solid comedy beat, there's some good setup here, and it's Old Man Cable's suspicion that whatever gets him is the work of Strife. Okay, so he tells Deadpool, like, whatever happened, whatever it looks like, I bet it was Strife. This is really interesting to me. So Strife, I'm not going to do the full thing here, but he is a clone of Cable who thinks he's the real Cable, okay? And it, typically just, like, in the pages of 90s X-Force, he's, like, the archenemy of Cable, right? As it stands, as you would expect from a clone who thinks they are you. The idea that the murder of Cable is actually Strife is really fascinating to me. Because it has, I've just kind of assumed, like, no, it's Teenage Cable, and he's here to stay. But what if Teen Cable actually has a Strife thing going on? And it's Teen Strife making a run at Old Man Cable and weaving himself into the Krakoa narrative, right? We're talking about clones, we're talking about time travel. Yeah, it can get super messy, but that's also a really interesting angle I hadn't considered before. So I'm curious to see if and how that might factor into this as well. The issue ends with the Krakoan reading time travel. No surprise there. Cable stole the time travel technology from Old Man Cable's arm. Again, I think Deadpool probably doesn't let him have it unless he's messed with it. But maybe he's just saying, ah, Cable used to be my friend. I'll let him have it. Whatever. I dig this book way more than I thought I would. I think Cable 1 through 3 has been very fun. I think Duggan does a great job with Deadpool as a supporting character. I'm not, like, head over heels about the run that he did with comedy writer Brian Posehn. In the Marvel Now era, it's good, though. I know that it's good. It's just, you know, not necessarily my speed. But his work here with Phil Noto, who, again, is doing incredible work. Like, seriously, just find someone to look at you the way Scott Summers looks at this Hoagie, right? And you will have a very satisfying life. I love Phil Noto interiors. I hope he stays on this book for a good long time. And in the meantime, Cable dating all of the Stepford Cuckoos, being a teenager and having fun for once in his life instead of the old grump, but still having the old grump around as a narrative device, it makes for some really compelling reading. And again, like, those connections to Marauders, to the Order of X, to sinister secrets that were unveiled in the pages of Marauders. I'm really enjoying how some of these X writers, Ben Percy's doing this too across, like, Wolverine and X-Force, the multiple books that they're writing are integrating together, right? And they're doing these things where, like, you don't have to read the other to understand what's going on necessarily, but if you are, there's additional payoff. And that's kind of what I love about the shared universe and continuity and all these crossovers and things that are going on. So I dug Cable. If you haven't been keeping up with this series, it's obviously going to get more important as we move into Ten of Swords, but it's very, very fun. So even though I wasn't, like, sold on the concept of Teen Cable, I don't think many were, this series is kind of doing it for me. So check it out. You can find my work at patreon.com/comicbookherald, ways to support the site. I want to thank in particular our mysterious benefactors. I'm going to shout them out by name here. Jeff Zacharias, Ron Paul Kirkley, Jesse W., Robert Mickelson, Professor Pride, Steve Brennan, Cole Weathers, Martin Lopez, Chris Isidro, and Darren Clark. Thank you for being mysterious benefactors, supporters of Comic Book Herald work. I'm Dave. You can find my stuff at comicbookherald.com, at Comic Book Herald, pretty much anywhere online. Look for the best comics ever in my Marvelous Year podcast coming up. A teaser, if you are listening to Krakin Krakoa here, I would recommend you check out the Comic Book Herald Krakin Krakoa playlist. Again, I've done 75 of these. There's a lot of good, you know, not just issue by issue stuff, but asking bigger questions about this era of X-Men and Krakoa. If you are so inclined, I have coming up the next couple episodes will be, well, one, I'm going to review the other X-Men issues that came out today. So Excalibur number 11 is top of mind at the moment, and that build to Ten of Swords. And then this weekend, I'm going to be releasing a big weekend question about a Ten of Swords theory about the classified sword bearer of Araka. So keep your eyes open for that as well. Otherwise, thanks for listening and enjoy the comics.